almost all the illustrations are from Steve Maschuk. You'd actually hear. He'll be doing some videotaping, but let's just jump right into it. So, Lovecraft, in spite of a lot of the stories conveying that science is revealing these horrors of the cosmos, he was a huge fan of science. And a matter of fact, he had a strong love for astronomy. He wrote quite a bit of information on astronomy between 1906 and 1918, and it's actually, most of that information is compiled in Collected Essays, Volume 3 by Joshi. In addition, he was a materialist and an atheist, so science was really the foundation of a lot of his philosophy. So let's just start big. So let's talk about the Big Bang and Azimuth, because this is something that comes up a lot. And if you're familiar with the Big Bang, early in the 20th century, Edwin Hubble was an astronomer who was looking at galaxies and collecting information on the light of galaxies, and it was revealed that everything in the universe was moving away from us and at an accelerated rate. And this is where we come up with the idea of the Big Bang theory. So if you reverse that moving of the Big Bang, we've estimated that the universe is between 13.7 and 14 billion years old. And there's a lot of information to help support that theory. Cosmic microwave background radiation, supernova, information on supernovas. But I'm not going to get into that. I want to talk more about the idea that Azimuth may be the Big Bang, or may have given rise to the Big Bang. And this is something that I believe Lumley was one of the first people to talk about. And one of the things that you hear about when you hear about Azimuth is he's the center of the universe. I'm going to provide some information. He may not necessarily be at the center of the universe, but it may be at the edge of the universe. So this is just showing a real simple schematic, the beginning of the universe, the quantum fluctuations, dark ages, and then boom, atoms were created, suns were ignited, and the universe is expanding a lot thanks to dark energy, which I'll be talking about a little later on. When you look at the quotes about Azimuth from Lovecraft, you hear things like the center of all infinity, rules all time and space from a black throne, lord of all things. Well, Azimuth may be part of our matter or all of our matter, and if that's the case, there may not necessarily be a center of the universe, even though from our perspective, where we live is the center of the universe, but anywhere you're at in the universe could be thought of as the center of the universe. But when you look at the outer edge of what we think of as the known universe, that's where Azimuth may be stretched at the very boundaries of the universe. And if we're going to go to the very boundaries of the universe, of our known universe, let's talk about the unified field theory, which is an attempt to take the four primal forces of our universe and put them into one equation or prediction. And the four forces of nature in our universe are electromagnetic, gravity, strong nuclear force, and weak nuclear force. And there have been a lot of inconsistencies, and there have been attempts to resolve these, primarily through quantum mechanics, which talks about the very small, and general relativity, which talks about the very large. And currently, string theories are really trying to resolve these issues. And strings are thought of as infinitely smaller than atoms, infinitely smaller than electrons. They are the very fabric of energy and matter. And different strings have different vibrations, and those vibrations give rise to different forms of matter or energy. So one vibration would give rise to an electron, one would give rise to a photon. Additionally, there are closed loop strings and there are open strings, and I'll talk about that a little later. So if you look at a quote like from Whisper in Darkness from Lovecraft, and you talk about the meter composed of a form of matter totally alien from our part of space, with electrons having wholly different vibrational rates. Did Lovecraft have the idea of string theory when he was talking about stuff like this? Matter not of our universe. Again, another quote from At the Mountains of Madness talking about the Cthulhu spawn and the Miku, how this matter is totally different and how it can do things that our matter is not familiar with, the modifications and the transformations. So, to get a better handle on this, let's go from the incredibly small, these strings, to the incredibly large membranes, also called brains. Now, the brains are thought of as two or more dimensional spaces. So basically, our universe is thought of as one of these membranes. We live in a three-dimensional membrane with an additional dimension, being time. But we're confined to this. We can't leave this. So most of the open strings, the electrons, the photons, everything that makes us up, we're stuck on this memory. We cannot move out of it. However, gravity is an open loop. It's a circular string. It can move through the membranes into others. And what's interesting about that is one of the reasons why theoretical physicists feel that gravity is so weak in our universe relative to the other forces, is because it can move through these spaces, these brains. I mean, this is an illustration of it. So if we look at our universe on the top, and there's other dimensions I don't have time to get into, little curled up dimensions, but between these brains are what's called the bulk. And so gravity can move through it, but all the others, the photons, the electrons, they're stuck in their particular membranes. So, according to Hawking's, with his calculations, how many universes could there be? Well, 10 to the 500. That's a big number. That's a big, big number. So you think of, there could be universes with no matter, there could be universes with no energy, no light, but there may be some universes very similar. You think of something like the Dreamlands, something where you could float a ship up to a moon where there's atmosphere. Well, if you tweak the gravity a little, maybe something like that would be possible. And remember, I talk about these membranes. Between them, there's the bulk, where you think of a story like From Beyond. The entities that either may pass through these membranes or entities that live within the bulk. And again, From Beyond, creating vibrations and frequencies that can open doors to other realities. Well, this is how they work, is again through string theory. And it's interesting, Lovecraft was very fascinated that we were very limited in our senses. So, for example, we only have 5 senses, and we see in the electromagnetic spectrum, we see the visible spectrum. Well, that's because our sun generates mostly visible light. So we're adapted to that situation. If our sun generated perhaps a lot of x-rays, maybe we'd be able to see in the x-ray portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. So you think of something like Yab-Sothoth, a congeries of iridescent globes. Yab-Sothoth may be something that's a multidimensional thing from another brain that's squeezed into our four-dimensional space-time. And maybe Yab-Sothoth is a sentient form of gravity from another universe. Cthulhu and its spawn, again, comes from another universe. I hypothesize that these entities may be plasma, which is ionized gas, not stable atoms, which would explain how they can change size and shape. But the most common form of matter in our universe is plasma, but it's always found in stars. So maybe that's where Cthulhu and its spawn originates from stars. And if that's the case, why don't these entities immediately burn up the Earth? Well, they may be venting this energy into another reality, into another universe. And something I want to bring up, another hypothesis in this Lovecraftian cosmos is, if you're familiar with the H.P. Lovecraft Literary Podcast, I went through all, you know, years ago, I went through all the episodes. It's a great show. And what's interesting is when you hear Chris and Chad talk about the various Lovecraftian stories, they always bring up, you know, these entities are so powerful, yet they're so easily defeated. Wilbur Whatley was taken down by a German shepherd. You know, Cthulhu was taken down by a ship. Why is this? Well, I hypothesize that these entities, they are very powerful, and they can manipulate time and energy and matter, but they're not adapted to our universe. So to squeeze into our universe, they either need help, or they're trying to somehow establish themselves to become stable entities in this universe. And that's their weakness, and who knows if they'll ever overcome that weakness. So to shift bases a little, dark matter and dark energy, if you've heard about this, if you look at gravity in the universe, and you estimate how much matter and energy there should be in the universe, our matter, the matter we're familiar with, only accounts for about 4% of the total matter and energy in the universe. About 23% of it is estimated to be dark matter, and another 73% is estimated to be dark energy. And it's ironic that Einstein thought the cosmological constant, it is E equals mc squared, was a blunder. But that constant was probably an explanation of dark matter and dark energy. This extra matter and energy will account for how the universe works. Because dark energy works as negative pressure, so it's expanding the universe. One of the big questions is, with all the matter, how come gravity doesn't make the universe collapse? Why is it expanding? Why is that expansion accelerating? Well, the idea is it's this dark energy, and it's this dark energy, that may be being used as a propulsion for a lot of these interstellar organisms. You know, the Migu and the Elder things, they may be taking advantage of that dark energy to go through the cosmos. I'm going to shift here into the evolution of terrestrial, extraterrestrial, and extradimensional life just very briefly. Elder things, even though they're very alien, they're from our universe, composed of the same matter as we are, and by their body appearance, more than likely, they were some type of alien sea star that evolved on some other planet somewhere else in the universe. Then you have organisms like the deep ones, the cone-shaped beings, and humans. All terrestrial life, more than likely, all produced by the elder things through their bioengineering. And then you have creatures like the Migu and the spawn of Cthulhu that are just made of different matter. And then finally, the flying polyps in color out of space, which is those things are even more difficult to categorize if they find flying polyps and the color out of space, whether or not they would be considered life. So just to go over one of these organisms, Migu, this is a little hypothetical larval stage of Migu. Again, made of different matter, it's actually feeding off of Pluto. Oh, sorry, Yuggoth. Here it is on Yuggoth. It's hyphae. It's fungal hyphae feeding on the surface of the planet. Almost entirely asexual, and when you're asexual, you can live forever. You're a clonal organism. You can just keep on reproducing copies of yourself and living on. Sexual reproduction means death, but it also means a shuffling of genes, which increases your chances of your species to move forward because you have more increased genetic variability, so you're better adapted to dealing with changes in the environment. In the case of the Migu, I think their evolution is very different. It's probably more of a form of Lamarckian evolution as opposed to Darwinian evolution, meaning that any change they do in their body parts, if they decide to put on extra limbs, then the spores that they create will have those extra limbs. So it's very different than, you know, where that shuffling of genes happen in sexual organisms between the egg and the sperm. Very different. So if we talk about Lovecraft and evolution, I'm always torn by Lovecraft because sometimes I feel like he had a really good grasp on evolution, meaning that he put humanity on level with everything else. That from an evolutionary perspective, we're no different than any other organism on the earth. You know, we go through the same genetic changes, we go through the same impacts with environmental changes, and that he perceived different organisms dominating the earth in the future. Alternatively, he obviously had a very racist view of evolution. And a lot of those racist views actually came from Ernest Haeckel, who, even though he was a proponent of Darwin's, he also had a very skewed racist view of evolution, ranking races of races of humanity. When you look at humans genetically, there's race really doesn't even exist. You know, from a biological perspective, the way you define race, humanity, an adult male and an adult female anywhere on the planet can have children. So that's one species. Race doesn't even mean that much in terms of evolution. Also, I did a little work on this, and according to Joshi, you know, Lovecraft really didn't read any of Darwin's work, but he did read quite a bit of Hegel's. So is this the master of future Earth? You know, some sort of large, intelligent beetle like Lovecraft proposed? I'm going to be wrapping up here, talking about flying polyps, which, again, something that's very alien. And if you think of these things, they were thought of as predators on the cone-shaped beings of ancient Earth. However, when the Ithians, these mindless entities we don't quite know, came from space and symbiotically joined with the cone-shaped beings to become the great race, and they developed technology, they actually combined the flying polyps. And it was quite simple how they got rid of them, is they had these boxes that generated electrical discharge. So, and it didn't just kill the flying polyps, it absolutely annihilated them. So my hypothesis is the flying polyps may be an arrangement of matter and antimatter generated by magnetic fields, but I mean, unless we got a flying polyp and a super collider, you know, I don't think the National Science Foundation would fund anything like that anyway. So to wrap up here, humanity traveling through the Lovecraftian cosmos. If you read Michio Kaku's book, The Future Mind, He actually talks about how a lot of the cutting edge of science is generating and creating neural networks, and they're becoming more complex every year. Well, it may eventually be possible to download someone's memories and personality into some sort of artificial system and literally transfer it through light into the cosmos. So Kaku was talking about these way stations in the universe and beaming consciousness through various parts of the universe. And this may be how we actually do deep interstellar travel, is not in spaceships, but beaming consciousness through the cosmos. And ironically, it's very similar to when you think of the Yithians beaming their consciousness into other entities on various worlds and planets. So thank you very much. If you're interested in more, we have the Lovecraftian Science WordPress page, there's a Facebook page, and if you're interested in contacting either Steve or myself, feel free to do so. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.